is, what is my mission?
Why are you here, Mr. Yeah. Kruger?
Well, let me start with a bit of background. You know that my father was stationed here the first time in 1939. Then he was here during World War II, from, you know, through the war, and then he came back in 1946 as magistrate. He was assistant magistrate in the latter part of World War II. And I came with my mother in 1946 when I was 2 years old. Now, obviously, I don't remember much, but I do remember something. So there were people who took care of me or with whom I played as a child, who some are deceased and some are still here. So, and then again, my father was here in 1966 for a period, and again 1974. Now, by that time I was at university or working, and I could not come easily, but I came sometimes. So over time, the Caprivi was very important to me, forming me as a person through the people I played with, who were all local people, and through the people who took care of me, and through the people that my father worked with, okay? So, now the important thing is this, Lineke Elofte Visser, who is working on a particular aspect of the history of the Caprivi, through her work, has made contact with all the kutas, the chiefs, many villages, and many officials. So she made it possible for me to come here for a short time and make contact with people easily. Okay. So that's what I'm here for. I'm making contact with people, visiting places, in order to understand my roots on the one hand, and on the other hand, understand how has Caprivi developed in the meantime. So we have been meeting all kinds of interesting people while I've been here for the short time, and we will continue. We meet the Kuta at Choi on Friday, at Bukalo on Tuesday. We are still hoping to go to Chichimani, but it's a little confused. And here we have a book. It's a book. So this book, it contains photographs taken by my father over time. So it has historical photographs of very interesting figures. So you see the Mamili from 1940, what date?
Let me zoom. Oh, Chinchimani 1940, Masiku Mamili.
Yes.
A fine man, and who is this other one? Shugmansbeg, 1940, Chief Chikamatondo, with right. Kami. Okay. Passed away in 18 July 1945. Yeah. All right. Hey. Very nice.
Yeah. Is it not fantastic?
Yes, very nice.
Very nice. Very nice.
So I'm going to close it now and continue with the interview.
Yes.
So this book, these are photographs, mostly photographs that my father took over time. Mm. Now that I look at them, I see he was a very good photographer. But most importantly, he was friends with these people. So if you see Chief Chikamatondo or the Mamili of the time, he was friends with those people. Mm. And they determined the way he related to people, and from him I learned that sort of thing. So in that way, the relationships built up in the Caprivi here were very important in forming me. So now this book, the photographs are taken by my father, mostly there's some early ones made by him, but it was compiled by Lineke Elofte Visser. And it is a pictorial history. Now, I'm trying to build a bit on that. I want to build a little bit on that and perhaps produce an article, which is an aspect of social history or political history, if you like. You know, we all know that our history in Namibia and South Africa has got its own particular qualities, But we know a little bit, nothing about the deep background. So that will be a small thing that I hope to do, is to write an article which builds on these and my experiences in meeting people now. So I've met the sons of, I met the son of the Mamili who is here today, mm-hmm. and we had a very good talk. Okay. I met the sons of a man called Robert Nchindo, who was a policeman here during my father's time. Mm-hmm. I met them yesterday.
All right.
And all of that process and begins to tell me what these people meant mm-hmm. to us. Okay. And but they keep telling me what my father meant to them as well. And they describe him as a kind man from whom they learned, and so on and so forth. Okay, so does that help you? Does that,
yes.
Am I explaining what I'm here for?
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I see. Mr. Kruger, maybe looking back on the historical, how people were living in this street, mm. up to date now. Maybe if you can give an overview. We understand it was during apartheid. Mm. So who was the predecessor for Mr. Kruger by that time? Your father before?
Yes, he was a man called French Trollope.
We have this. Yeah.
You do, yes. He was a man called French Trollope. Now, I don't know too much about him, but I do know that people do remember him here. I think when my father came, you must remember that in 1946, for every, the population here was about 50,000, now it's something like 150,000. Mm. So there's been a big change because the population has grown, then there's been a big change because the economy has changed. Mm. So now more people are earning cash incomes. And they're able to purchase rather than produce their own requirements. That change we must recognize. When my father was here, he was administering a territory which was mainly agricultural, very traditional, and in which the apartheid government back in Pretoria promoted the traditional. So for example, it was not permitted that white people could come and make a business here. And we have the records showing how many times it was refused. Now that has changed. You have all kinds of businesses here nowadays. So the whole social structure, the traditional pattern, the economic structure has all changed over time. And for me that's very interesting to see. And it's good, and what has been striking me is if you look at Katima, Katima is a very neat, clean, well-planned, well-built village. All the structures are sound. We were in today in one of the houses in the village here, and it's a very well-built house. Now, I don't want to draw comparisons, but I can take you to other places where things have not developed that way. It's a scrambled mess. The structures are poor. The roads are poor and everything. Katima is a model town, mm-hmm. in my view. Mm-hmm. It's really good to see that.
Mm-hmm. So now, I don't know, even though there's still political conflict between, the ancestors, so to say, the new generation. I understand by that time, 1946, when the late your father was here, for the whole as a territory, Caprivi Strip, there was no political independence for the black community. But what was powerful was, as you have just mentioned, it was traditional. Mm. I would say the chiefs were the one who were ruling by that time. So now, how can you describe the situation at the moment, comparing the past and the new generation, since there's some political mm-hmm. conflict? We understand some, they are fighting for this territory, saying historically they
You mean
people
here
are divided
in Caprivi?
Yes, in Caprivi. Yeah. Some they are in exile, you know, fighting for the independence of this area, and some they are in, you know, I don't know, how can you shed some light, I mean, giving advice or looking on your, you know, your how you have seen, I mean, the social factors of this community, the political, I mean, supremacy of the area, I mean, maybe if you can just clear out.
Well, one thing I cannot do is give advice, okay?
Okay. All right.
Secondly, I know just very little.
Okay.
However, what I do see is that you have a dual system,
okay,
that the traditional Kuta is still very important in many different ways, such as the allocation of land to live on, or land to cultivate, and to resolve community issues, community conflicts, and so on. So I see that is still a very strong institution.
Okay.
At the same time, you have a democratic system, where you elect representatives to the parliament in Vindhu.
So it's two systems.
Yeah, it's two systems running in parallel. And the impression I have at this stage, look, be sure of one thing. Political development takes a long time, and there's many conflicts, and there's much to and fro, like we are seeing in South Africa now. But in Europe, it took hundreds of years for the new institutions, the institutions we see today, to develop. In Africa, the development is happening very, very rapidly, but it still takes some time. So, I think what I see in the Caprivi is we know that in the background there is conflict. There is conflict at the national political level that expresses itself here through events that maybe you can't understand otherwise. There's also conflict within the local community, the local institutions. That's part of the democratic process.
Okay.
You know, it will be so, but every one of us must be citizens, and we must work as citizens to play our part in the development of a democracy. That's all I can say. Back in South Africa, we are having very difficult times right now. What do I say to myself? I say I must do what I can to make a contribution, even if it's very small. I don't know whether I'm responding very well to your question.
There are still some issues here, surrounding here. I think that as now you said you are 71 years old. Maybe looking on the history again, you know, there are some views people are saying, no, who was the first chief, so to say,
yes,
at that time?
Yeah.
You hear my ears, they say, you know, they're the one who came first.
Yes.
The Mafwe, they say, they're the one who came first.
Yes.
The Masubia, they say, they're the one who came first.
Yes.
Before the First World War,
yeah,
German, British came here. Maybe I don't know how can you describe on that?
Well, you have now yourself said that is an old, old story. And that it has gone this way and that way over time. I know nothing more than that. I can say no more than that. African traditional institutions are very interesting. So,
because now you mentioned to me that you'll be visiting,
yes,
all four traditional authorities.
Yes.
But before there were two.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah.
Like I'll two is two.
Yeah. Well, you know, that's the process of evolution.
Okay.
Face that. The reason why we're visiting them is we want to make a presentation of this book.
Okay.
And the reason why we want to make a presentation of the book is it's a small contribution,
okay,
to capturing more of the history of the Caprivi. In South Africa today...
Can I have a look?
Yes. We are going through much turmoil. And you will hear one version of history and another version of the same history. But at the end of the day, we must share a common knowledge of our history. So even though one person or one institution can only make a small part of the bigger story, we must make those parts.
Okay.
So we must develop these stories. Now, I can do very little here on my short visit, but that book, I hope, is a contribution which will tell people and say, well, look, see here. As everyone we've visited so far, when they look at that book, they say, oh, look, there is that man, or this is where that happened. And one of the people we showed it to the other day picked it up and he saw his father and he kissed the picture because he had not seen that picture of his father in school. So it is
a colorful,
a small part, but a very...
Very colorful
history. Yeah.
It tells.
Yeah.
So in that book, do you have pictures of your father?
Yes.
Okay. Because we are looking for
we
that.
Don't know
okay.
him.
We don't know him.
Oh, you don't? Oh, you do. Okay, look, I tell you what...
The picture? So that
will we have one copy? Oh.
No, I tell you what, let me explain.
All right.
Benjamin. Benjamin will have a digital copy of this whole thing. Unfortunately, we only have enough for the kudos right now. So he will have that, and you can get it from him and print it as you like. So in that you will find, I hope, whatever you want. But through Benjamin, you can also communicate and ask for more. Look, what I did is I took all my father's photographs and I scanned them.
Okay.
These are some of them. There may be some others that will be useful. And if you remind me through Benjamin or Lineke, I will be sure that there are some pictures
of
my father.
So do you have your email maybe?
Yes, let me write it for you.
Yeah, then it's better.
Okay.
Let me write it.
To the book. Who funded the project?
It's out of our own pockets.
Out of our own pockets.
Yeah.
It's printed where?
Printed in Holland, in the Netherlands.
Netherlands, eh?
Yeah. Okay. But with the file, the digital file, you can have it printed here or in Vintuk at the print shop.
Okay. Yeah. All right.
Yeah.
Okay.
It's free of charge to the Kutas, eh? You'll be giving it.
Yes,
to...
free of charge, yeah.
Okay.
And the way can we have that copy in the future?
So for as example, I was
people,
saying, Benjamin...
Either in the National Archive,
no, you'll have a digital file.
Okay.
You can get a digital file from Benjamin.
Sometimes it can be, human error.
Okay.
You're supposed to have even one to two copies free for the public library. Young generation, those who are growing.
Let me talk to Lineke about it. She's going to Windhoek.
Definitely.
It's her compilation. Okay. She's going to Windhoek. Maybe we can make an arrangement about
that.
But it may be not as nicely bound as this. I don't know what is possible, okay? Okay, but let me talk to her about it, okay?
Definitely.
All right. My final message. I am trained in science, and in a particular field of science, which is ecology and the natural environment. However, I have been working with historians in writing environmental history for South Africa. From those historians, I've learned that it is very important to capture your histories so that the present generation can be aware of the past and what has been learnt and where you come from.
Mm-hmm.
And I would say, do more work of that kind here in the Caprivi. They tell me that the history book in schools for Namibia has only got a short section on Caprivi. But that section has become a chapter. Mm-hmm. See, that's my final message, I would say.
Okay.
Okay.
Thank you very much.
Yeah, and I tell you what, I'm very pleased. Thank you for giving me the grace to meet you and to have the interview.
Mm-hmm.
I always think the local newspapers are very important. And I must get a copy of yours, which I'll find in the garage or in the supermarkets. Or
give you one.
Okay.
Yes. Maybe you still have another question. Maybe a little bit, your profile, maybe. Can you tell us a little bit of your profile, when were you born, and
Yes, okay.
What you have done so far, your work,
yeah.
How many children you have.
All right, I'll do that.
You are the son of the late Kruger, yes. Magistrate. Are you the firstborn, secondborn,
yeah.
Or what? How many of you, in your family,
okay.
Up to now, maybe?
Yeah.
Yeah, I think that would be
yes,
last
well,
question, maybe
okay.
Profile as well.
No, I am the firstborn of Captain Kruger, is what people call him here.
Okay.
I was born on the 9th of March 1944 in Pretoria.
In Pretoria?
Yes, but my father's job, he was sent everywhere. So I grew up in many places in Southern Africa, Namibia, South Africa. I went to university and I took a degree in forestry, in forest science, and then I specialized in fields of research. And for a significant period of about 12 years, I was doing scientific research in the Cape. And then I became responsible for a bigger program, and then eventually I became director of the National Institute in South Africa of Forest Research. But from 1994 onwards, I became drawn into the development of new public policies for South Africa, working with the new government, the cabinet ministers in government, on forestry, water, land, and such elements of public policy.
Good.
And after that, I was involved as a consultant.
Okay.
No, I left my job and I became a consultant. And worked on different initiatives to implement the policies, to training, education, systems. But for the last 5 or more years, I've become more academic. I teach a little bit on a university accredited program. I do historical research I have a colleague in Australia, and we work on environmental history. And I do, I write. So I've become an academic.
Yeah,
so what else did you ask me? Oh yes, I have 4 children, 2 girls, 2 boys, and they're all in different fields. So my youngest is a daughter, she is doing a doctorate in anthropology. My next is a son who is, he's a photographer in Cape Town, but he specializes in art photography. And then my next is a son who has a doctorate in ecology, and he's an academic. And my eldest is a daughter, and she specializes in organic gardening, teaching people organic gardening. So, yeah, there's a bit of my profile. I hope that is what you're looking for.
Yes. Okay.
So. In telling you that about my profile, I can say again that that profile was informed by my experiences here as a child. Also, we also lived in Kavango for an important period in the mid-50s. And there too, my experiences were very important. So people taught me how to make bow and arrows,
okay.
How to make traps to trap birds.
Right.
Oh, you know how to make traps.
Yeah, and all that sort of thing.
Mm-hmm.
And they taught me which plants I must not disturb and those that may be disturbed. So I learned very important things here and in Avamba.
So for how long did you live here in the Caprivi?
Not long. 2.5 years when I was a little boy.
Okay.
Then in the 1960s, I was already at university, so only the holidays here.
All right.
So not long, but a very strong impression.
You cannot remember the house.
Yeah, I remember it. I'm going there.
Okay.
I'm going to photograph it again. I looked at that the other day. It's very much the same as it was.
Okay.
Yeah. Katima is a well-developed and a well-preserved town.
Mm.
I'm telling you. It's really good.
There is a potential here.
Yeah, for sure. Yeah.
Even for investors.
Yes, you must recognize that in Africa we face special challenges. So, like in America, the Midwest of America, they have rivers that run right into the center of the Midwest, which are navigable. So they can grow maize and whatever it is and export on barges to the rest of the world. Here in Africa, your grow maize here, you've got to sell it locally.
Talk about tomorrow.